I think they should take all the questions that were raised as important inputs into their further analysis. It's extremely important to look at all the issues that were raised today. And I totally agree with Dr. Veena Sathrugna that this you should really relate these figures to the socio-economic background of the children. And because, let me add here, poverty is not an individual's attribute. It is generated by the system, social system. Right? You must focus on child and embedding the child in the social, cultural, economic context. Only you will be able to understand the various kinds of deprivations that the children undergo and various kinds of exclusions they suffer from. And I think it's extremely important to place the children in this kind of system of stratification, class structure, caste structure, and also communities. And only then you will be able to understand childhood poverty better. It's not an individual's attribute. It's not an individual's failure that a child is a poor child, right? Poverty also is quite dynamic. I think one should also see a child is born into a family which is poor, right? That's one category of families. You can also see as children grow, some households fall into a poverty trap. That's an important dimension that one should look at. Basically, the temporal study that you're carrying out, you must trace how many, in how many cases children, their households have become poorer over time. Yes, so I think it's important to do this analysis. And I also would like to add that all the groups that are involved in these livelihood studies across the nations, especially those who are carrying out quantitative studies, they must pick up a subsample of the total sample of 10% and then do in-depth interview with the children, also with the parents of the children. Then your data will be meaningful. You will add richness to your data. Just giving these figures and not relating them to the context will not take us anywhere. So you, I think there should be, all the investigators must make it a point to do a subsample, pick up a subsample randomly and do an in-depth interviews with them. That will give us much more insights rather than simple numbers. See, numbers will only tell us some regularities, also tell us what's happening, but we must understand the underlying processes by focusing on the basically qualitative methodology will give you an understanding of the micro-level processes. That is extremely important to understand these micro-level processes. And it's true, yes, children at the age of 12, if there are 20% of them are working, it's a matter of concern. And see, the employers, in many cases, they would like to propagate some myths, as Dr. Dawluri said, that they said children are preferred. It is nothing to do with children's capabilities or children's so-called the nimble fingers. See, there's a theory in labor studies today. They say in the case of tissue culture industry, many women are employed, right? They say women have nimble fingers. Tissue culture requires very delicate hands to deal with the saplings. All these myths are propagated basically to keep labor docile, to keep labor under the control of management. And in this case, children are much more vulnerable because they can't even raise a voice against these employers. So I think one should place this whole work of children in a larger context and understand what is happening, as it is basically every employer, every organization wants to cut costs at any cost, right? By employing children, by employing women, and so on. See, childhood poverty, as I said, is not a children's, a child's attribute. It is the context in which a child is born, a child is growing, the family, the household in which is born, the society in which is growing. So I think that has to be understood. And I also would like to tell the investigators to look for children, or if they already have in the sample, children who are physically challenged. I don't know how many were really were seen or identified as part of this sample. That group is another highly excluded group. So I'm sure there are some instances where children who are physically challenged, they face many more and much more greater deprivations compared to a normal child. So both mental harassment, mental problems, and also their physical problems, I think it's an important aspect of the exclusion, and how many children have such disabilities, and what are their kind of how do they cope up with their poverty on account of being born in a poor household and on account of being a physically challenged child. I think these are important questions that we should focus on, and I'm sure at the end of it, it's too early to talk about policy interventions. We have not even analyzed the data fully, at least this study. I'm sure the next round of a workshop or a conference will, I think the PIs will make a better presentation with the complete analysis. And I'm sure, as I said in the beginning,
he is concentrated among poorer households, with only 20% of children in the wealthiest 25% of the households being stunted, in comparison to 46.7% in the bottom 25%. There is marked heterogeneity in the prevalence of stunting by caste. In both rounds, stunting is highest for scheduled tribes and lowest for the other castes. Finally, stunting is more common among boys than girls in both the rounds. Data revealed in the children who, then this is the story, but it disaggregate levels of presentation of the stunting hides many facts. Because suppose if you let the tribals, the scheduled tribes, we can see there is a decrease in the stunting. We don't know, we have to explain the reasons. We have not done an exercise to explain the reasons why the stunting among the tribals has declined compared to all other caste groups. It's a question I flag it for discussion. And data revealed that, the data, two set data sets revealed, first round and second round, the children who were moderately stunted and severely stunted in the first round improved their nutritional status in second round. That's the catching up phenomena. I don't know whether to label it as a catching up or increase, whatever, I don't know really. We are sick, that's why we thought that to present and get the feedback, the people who have worked in this area down the decades. Now, I try to correlate some of the important variables. It's not a complete kind of variables I have considered to explain these variations, but try to pick up some of the important variables which are having a policy implication. These are the broad kind of broad heads of issues, I mean indicators we have taken. Indicators are dealing with the maternal health care and child care and household status and caregiver's employment. Because in Andhra Pradesh, 98% of the women are the caregivers. And now maternal health care, I would like to present, you know, briefly two, three important variables which reflects on that. The likelihood of malnourishment decreases with an, I'm just confining comparison between the catching up, I call them as the catching up, and people and the group of children where there is a deterioration in their malnutrition, in their nutrition status. That means the malnutrition has increased. Incidence of children, or the children, proportion of children who are malnourished has deteriorated. Their nutrition has deteriorated with the first and second round. So the likelihood of malnourishment decreases with the number of antenatal care visits. Mothers, this is a very established kind of thing. But we also need the question, when this mother has gone for first antenatal care check, we do have the data, but we are not presented here. Mother's antenatal care visits during pregnancy is more among the catching up groups, 4.78, there is not much difference, but just for this important indicator, I thought we should present here, that then of nutrition deterioration group, children of nutritional deterioration group, 4.62. BMI, body mass index of the mothers, which talks about the health status of the nutrition status of the mother, mothers of children catching up is around 22.34, is more than that of the children group who are deteriorating. There is a deterioration in their nutritional status. That is 21.29. And then we have taken the child care indicators. Children in the group of deterioration are breastfed for more number of months than children in catching up. It's not a straight way relationship to say that there are certain variables behaving in a different way. We don't know. The variables which talk about for the nutrition, explaining the nutritional variations may be different from the variables which are expected to explain the catching up and deterioration kind of thing. I'm not sure of it. Just I'm throwing up. It is 15.24 and 15.17 months respectively in case of children in deterioration and catching up. But if you look at the NFHS data, the data is that 23 months the children were fed, which is 1 month less of World Health Organization standard. 2 years the child is expected to be fed by the mother. Children in the group of deterioration, maybe this is a proper sample, that's why you got this less number of months, and we don't know. We have to just look at the data or just to find the explanation, adequate explanation. Children in the group of deterioration were given solid food at the early age, 5.15 months, then those are catching up 5.77. It's also, we have to put them together and see what is happening to this variable influencing the deterioration and catching up. Number of months breastfed and introduction of solid food did not show much impact on catching up children, catching up phenomena of the children. The number of weeks the children born before the expected date, premature birth, are more among deteriorating children compared to them catching up children. This may be one of the reasons which clearly explains. And child care further, 76% of the children in catching up are vaccinated against measles, and it is less among deterioration kind of children, because I have not taken the polio and other kind of things, but they have been covered fully. And only this indicator, which is very striking kind of thing, that's why we try to put this variable here. Proportion of children having poor appetite, because there are 10 questions we asked for to understand what is the yesterday's health status of the child, because it will have impact on the stunting, it may be having more impact on the underweight also, with more impact on the stunting. So what we found is the proportion of children having poor appetite are more significant among group of children where there is a deterioration in that nutrition status than catching up children. Proportion of children taking midday meals at school is much less among deterioration than that of catching up children. You can ask me the question, why you are talking about the midday meal program, that's a school meal and where the children must go to school. Our children are only 4.5 to 5.5 years. And the midday meal issue rises only in the second round, not in the first round, because the children in the first round were 6 to 18 months old. But we have observed when we prepared this preliminary report that the children who are not eligible, officially not eligible age to go, the children to go to the school, the 40% of the children went to school because of the midday meal. That's the question to be looked at. So midday meals, the children, but this is gives an indication that even in later years of the life of the child, there is a possibility of improving the nutrition status by providing the midday meal program, providing the adequate food. I don't know. This is a question to be discussed here. However, 35% of children of deterioration are taking part in other food nutrition supplement, ICC disease program. It is higher than that of catching up children. It shows no relationship. I have given the diagrams to make it very clear. And then household status. Proportion of illiterate caregivers is more among catching up than deterioration. It is counterintuitive. But we think that just having an education may not be adequate. We need an education on the health and nutritional kind of things, because what diet we have to, dietary recommendations, dietary kind of things we have to follow, because that is expected to be provided by the ICDS program. But it seems that that's much more important in explaining the variations in the catching up and the deterioration kind of situation. Purushadipur is a very interesting thing, that's quite obvious, a standard kind of thing. Purushadipur is more among deterioration children than the catching up children. So Purushadipur are more concentrated, the children who are come from poverty status are more subjected to the kind of nutrition deterioration. And poor hygiene and service conditions at home at the initial years of the birth of the child have impact on child nutrition, because the access to drainage, sanitation, and even the electricity, these are the important things which are very important to provide an atmosphere where the children, whatever he takes up, can be converted into a energy, nutrition. That's very important. The Sukhat means kind of formulation. Incidence of occurrence of shocks, this is very important, in the household decreased from initial year of the birth of the child to the next 5 years. However, incidence of number of events is more in case of deterioration. That means vulnerability conditions. If the households are subjected to covariant or individual idiosyncratic kind of shocks and do not have the proper wherewithal to cope with this, it will have impact that children will be drawn and food will be cut down, food security problem arises, and some children will be drawn from the school also. It happens. So the social security system must be very strong to take care of these vulnerabilities of these individuals. Death of the households in the initial year of the birth of the child has more effect on the child nutrition. 59% of households of deterioration and only 47% of the catching up has serious deaths in the first round. But after 5 years, households having serious death is more in catching up. And caregivers impart. This is now the very, people talk about only the traditional kind of indicators, safe motherhood and childhood practices, and other kind of public policies. but it's also important public policies that employment of women, which decide the intra-household allocation of the resources, so women must be empowered. Whether it has any kind of sense we can make up from the simple indicators which are collected from our data, they may not be comprehensive. If you want to measure the empowerment, it has to be measured in different ways, the power within, power with, and power to, and these kind of concepts we have to use, because it's a comprehensive thing. But just to, as if to give a flavor of empowerment, we have considered two, three indicators I would like to present here. This is in public domain and private domain. Willingness of mother by pregnancy, for pregnancy, leads to improvement in nutrition, because mother must be willing to, because this, we talk about, the feminist talk about this as a control over body. This is a very important indicator. And that we try to look at whether the decision-making process of the individuals, the women are participated in getting the pregnancy, whether they like it or not at the time of the conceiving thing. So mothers willing to be pregnant at the time of is 90% among deterioration children and 91% among catching up. Whether 1% makes sense or not, I don't know, but this is the result came up. And proportion of women joining together with other community members to address a problem are more in catching up than in deterioration. This we talk about the women's participation in public spaces to rectify the institutions that are expected to deliver the services to the children and to others also. And this seems to be having a clear-cut impact on the catching up process. More percentage of mothers in the group of deterioration are taking with the local authority or government organization about common community problems than those of catching up. This seems to be, for us, is a counterintuitive. When H0 we formulated and H1 we got, seems to be, it's not there in one line. So in this presentation, we try to see the basic argument. If you look at any NFHS reports or the arguments put up by any academic policy makers, if the child is not taken care of within 3 years, and a newly born child, and subsequently the safe motherhood and safe childhood practices, immunization, and delivery at the safe deliveries, those kind of things, then they may not be rectified in subsequent times. That is the thing that has come out even in NFHS rounds. That's the reason this project has given the opportunity to put the initial conditions of relating to safe motherhood and child safety childhood, and also about the household socio-economic conditions, whether they have impacted. If there is any improvement in the during the 5 years, whether it's an impact on the nutrition status in catching up process, but we found neither the things which we have included, because deltas we have taken in terms of the what was the indebtedness of the households. I mean, how many households have reported indebtedness in the first round? How many households reported serious indebtedness in the second round? In second round, if there is a decline in case of the catching up households, it doesn't have any impact at all. We strongly feel this methodology of putting the initial conditions, adding on the second conditions, to see whether there's improvement in other parameters, not the parameters relating to safe motherhood and childhood practices, will have any impact in catching up, improving or deteriorating the situation. And vulnerability I talked about, because along with other factors, vulnerability of the households has a greater role to play in regard to the catching up and deterioration of the status of the children. Thank you very much. This is the brief presentation.